Hello, welcome to Podsongs. I'm Jack Stafford, and I interview inspiring people in service to others as inspiration for a new song. Today, I'm joined by a guest singer, Angela Predhomme from Detroit. Together, we're interviewing the professor of African American Studies at Princeton University. His recent book, Begin Again, about James Baldwin and the history of American politics, was undoubtedly one of, if not the standout book of 2020. Let's welcome Eddie Glaude. So what made you pick Eddie to interview?
Well, it's Black History Month, and I thought that his perspective might be very interesting, and I checked him out a little bit on videos, something on YouTube, and he seems like a really compelling speaker. You know, I'm interested in that kind of thing. You know, I have my undergraduate degree is in social science. So, you know, I actually had like an African-American literature class, and, you know, and I'm not that far from Detroit. So I guess I'm very familiar with, you know, the situation of minorities in America, and it's, you know, it's not good, but it's slowly kind of getting better. Like, we think it's getting better, and then it, you know, something bad happens, but, and then we had a president that went the wrong way, you know, but yeah, so I just kind of sympathize with, you know, African Americans.
You added Song Time for a Change as well, I saw.
Yeah. Thank you for checking out my stuff. So Time for a Change, I wrote in 2016 when things in America were starting to get really controversial, and there were some things, you know, that kind of the anti-immigration and the problems, you know, with minorities and things like that, you know, where there was, you know, this new rise in bigotry was happening. And so Time for a Change. And, you know, and have you heard of the Flint water crisis?
Yeah, Flint, Michigan. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's only like 45 minutes from me. And so the song was sort of, you know, it started out to be inspired by that. You know, the first line is, there must be something in the water. And then it sort of expanded to include all the other crazy stuff that started happening after that, you know, in America.
I heard Eddie interviewed on Michael Moore's show on a podcast.
Oh, they
had a great chat. Yeah.
So does Michael Moore has a podcast?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah, he's very good. I mean, I'm looking at this through, let's just put me in perspective here. I'm looking at America through a telescope, you know, I've been there, but I'm not really qualified to, as an Englishman in Italy. So you are in a much better position to, because you're, that's why you're on the show, you know?
To give you an example, you know, my daughter has an African-American boyfriend, and I live in a very white area, and I actually, you know, it's sad. I have to worry about him driving over here, you know, getting pulled over by cops. You know, there's a lot of racial profiling, you know, things like that.
Really?
Yeah, things like that can happen, you know, in these outstate areas of Michigan, you know, in areas where there aren't many Black people. You know, if there's, you know, a person of color driving, they might get pulled over. And that's just because of a, you know, discrimination by the cops.
Hello, Eddie.
Hello, how are you?
Great, thank you. So this is Angela, who's a singer in Michigan.
Hi, Angela.
Hi. It's a pleasure to meet you, and an honor.
It's my pleasure.
And do you have, I always ask my guests just because how much time you reserved? What time do we have a hard out? Stop. Hard stop, it's called.
I don't know. I mean, how much time do you need?
Well, 45 minutes to an hour.
Yeah. I think she set us up from 1 to 2. Yeah.
All right, perfect.
just to know to wind it up then. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us.
Sure. Sure. It's my pleasure.
And I want to congratulate you on your on the book, which is Begin Again, which is still in hardback, but as I saw on Amazon, it's over 5,000 five-star reviews, and it's not available in Italy where I am at the moment.
It's not available? Where?
No, it's not available on Amazon in Italy yet.
Yeah, wow. So, we're going to have to change that. We're going to have to make that, you know, because I have one book already in Italian that's been translated in Italian. So we have to see what we can do here. That's not acceptable.
So have you been surprised by the phenomenal response, or were you?
Yeah. You know, because it's the late Baldwin, you know, it's the Baldwin that many people think, or many people believed was angry. He had left behind his art, that he was bitter. And the fact that it's that Baldwin that I'm engaged in conversation with that has kind of taken, you know, that's captured people's attention. It's just has been really surprising, but pleasantly so, you know. It's I didn't expect this, but I'm happy.
Because it's a labor of love. You've been lecturing on him for many years, so you must have really have his voice in your head, no?
Yeah, you know, he's everywhere. He's always around. He's always kind of moving me about. You know, it's just kind of trying to figure out how, you know, the biggest challenge writing with him, because it's not a book about Baldwin, it's a book where I'm writing with him, was trying to be mindful of my own voice, not to imitate, to try not to, you know, to write sentences like his, to write my sentences, to not try to sound like him, although that's hard not to do. So it was, you know, and, you know, he insisted, at least in my head, that I do that, you know, that I not try to imitate, that I be myself. So he's an exacting companion. Let's just put it this way. It's a lot of Irish whiskey that has been consumed over the...
with cognac. Coffee with cognac.
Yeah, a lot of Irish whiskey. Yeah, indeed.
So and did you originally start with this idea of writing a biography, and did it evolve into this unique format, huh?
Yeah, I initially wanted to write an intellectual biography of him, you know, because Baldwin has been shaping my work for a long time, right? I mean, he's everywhere in Democracy in Black, and which was the book before this one, and In a Shade of Blue, which is actually translated in Italian. Every chapter, except for the last one, begins with an epigraph from Baldwin. So he's been in my thing. And so I decided to usher him onto the stage, right? No, you can't be behind stage. I'm going to think about you. I'm going to write something about you that's different. But, you know, the archive wasn't as generous. You know, much of his letters are embargoed for the next 30 years. So, you know, that definitive biography isn't going to be written for a while until people can get their hands on those. So I remember I signed this contract. I'm a year in. I haven't written one sentence. I need to do something, and plus I was despairing and disillusioned, and so it's in that context that, you know, this form emerged, right? Because it's a particularly experimental kind of way, at least to my mind, of trying to write about history, not through flashback, but to kind of think about a through line, a thread. How, you know, a particular event or moment or thought can lead you back, and then how do you make your way back to the present? So the kind of movement back and forth, you know, so it, yeah, so I decided to write this book, or I fell into writing this book, might be a better way of putting it.
Okay, and we were talking with Angela just before you came on about sometimes the spiritual aspect of songwriting, that it just comes to you in a dream, or you feel someone's writing over your shoulder. Did you have that feeling with the book?
Oh, absolutely. I have a spirit candle with Baldwin, a Baldwin spirit candle that was next to me. And then Bishop Barber, who is the co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, sent me another one. I would get up in the middle of the night and, you know, that witching hour of 3 a.m., 4 a.m. in the morning, and and just scribble in my mold book, or how the title of the book came. You know, my editor wanted the book to, you know, have James Baldwin in the title, you know. And I was teaching a seminar and boom, this quotation from just above my head came out. And I was like, there it is. And I just kept thinking about the symmetry of it. You know, five letters, begin again, you know, how quick it was. So, it's...
That's cool.
Yeah, you know, just...
So what exactly is a spirit candle?
Let me show you. I'll show it to you.
Okay. Because I'm into metaphysical stuff, but I'd never heard of that.
You know, it's like a candle of the saints. It's like a candle of the saints, you know?
Oh, okay. I can't see it, though.
Okay, I'm going to bring it. I'll pull it up. Let me just get that.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It's like a saint's candle, you know?
Oh, that's cool. You got it with his name. How did you have somebody make that?
They have several, you know, in places. Around the country, in New York in particular, yeah, they do a lot of these, so, you know.
That's really cool. Yeah. And do you feel like that helped you to bring him in and sort of channel that energy and his message?
I think more than anything, it helped me understand the significance of what I was writing.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't so much about some tangible connection that the candle represented, or some sense that, you know, some concrete sense that his spirit was working on me or in me in some ways, but it just reminded me of the stakes of what I was writing. So, you know, whenever I hit that wall and I needed to do something, boop, just look at it, boom, I'm good. Or I could understand that, there were moments where it felt like, you know, he was leading me in particular directions, you know, so I hit a dead end and then suddenly someone would call.
Oh, wow.
Or, you know, there's this wonderful story. One of the first biographies of Baldwin. Is this what we're supposed to be doing?
Oh,
I think 100% Jack's pretty
inspiration.
I think,
Yeah. One of the first biographies of Baldwin was written by Fern Margie Ekman. And you know, it's an interesting book. It's not very good, actually, but it's full of all of these quotations. And I'm like, where are these tapes? I need these tapes. I want to hear these interviews and all of their detail. And they weren't in the Schomburg. They weren't located in the Smithsonian. They weren't in any library. And my writing partner is Imani Perry, who's written some amazing stuff on Lorraine Hansberry and the like. And she said, well, why don't you, you know, try to find Fern Margie Ekman? And it's like, she has to be like 100. What are you talking about? And so she looks at me and she smiles and then she walks upstairs to her office. And then I get an email with like three numbers in New York. So I said, what the hell? And I called the first number and boom, it was Fern Margie Ekman's house.
Oh my gosh.
And she was damn near 100. Her hospice worker was, you know, the hospice folks were there and she told me to call back. And then I called back and I made contact with her, her niece. And her niece was like, well, you know, I'm about to move her out of this apartment she's been in for about, you know, 50, 60 years. Maybe you can come visit. And I go to visit and she says, well, the tapes are gone. I can't find them, but there are these transcriptions. And I'm thinking I'm going to get 20 pages. And it's 100 pages of these transcribed interviews. And
wow.
Fern Margie Ekman died within the week or two weeks.
So that was meant to be, that you connected with her and you got those.
Yeah, and it turned out that her niece and I, you know, I, you know, she actually published some of those transcripts in the New Yorker. Mm. I kind of connected her niece, who always wanted to write in the New Yorker. I kind of connected her with David. It's just those sorts of moments happened over and over again.
That is very cool.
Yeah, yeah.
So why was under embargo for 30 years, his work, the sum of it?
I don't know. The family is, you know, the family is a complicated, you know, lot, you know. Thank God for, you know, Carol Weinstein, who was David Baldwin's partner. So Carol, David is Baldwin's brother, and they were really close. Carol is the mother of David's son, Daniel Baldwin. So I'm one of those, another kismet moment. I'm struggling, and then suddenly I get an email, and it's from Carol. I saw you on MSNBC talking about Baldwin. I knew him well. I'm the mother of David's son. Would you like to meet? And so we met at the Red Rooster in Harlem. And we just struck up this wonderful relationship. And she gave me all of this stuff from her own personal archive, stuff I had never seen before. But, you know, I couldn't get access to Gloria or to his sisters or, you know, the estate, the lawyer who was over the estate is retiring. So the family's just a complex lot. And I think there are some, you know, religious issues around his sexuality that still, you know, kind of gets in the way. We haven't, so, you know, there's a reason why we haven't had that particular biography written of him yet.
Yeah. And you all went all the way over to Paris, didn't you? And saw the building he lived in was being torn down. And
yeah, I was in Heidelberg at the time. I was a guest lecturer. You know, I was just received an award from Heidelberg University and I had to teach a class over 4 weeks or something like that. And I came in to teach the course, and it was great because I had this flat in the new town of Heidelberg. And so I write about this in the book and the like, but, you know, one of the things I knew that I could get on take a quick flight to Nice and then just, you know, get in a cab and just take the cab to St. Paul de Vence. And I did. And, you know, it was this weird thing, you know. So I fly into Nice and I have on these cream colored jeans with this linen blue shirt that's hanging down. And I get in the cab and the cab driver looks like he's straight from South Jersey. Mm-hmm. Right. He has this stereotypical look about him. Right. And he says he's practicing his English with me. And he asked me why I'm here. And I said, I'm going to look at the home of a famous writer who lived in St. Paul de Vence. And I think he knew something of Baldwin, but then he told me something. He said, oh, you have to visit now. And I was like, why? Because there's a national party tonight. And I was like, what is that? And so it was this evening where all of France was engaged in this party.
DJs
were all over the country. And
they do that? They
just it was weird, you know?
Yeah.
And so
you'd think that would happen in America before. But
he said, so they're going to shut down. Nice is going to shut down, you know, at this time. So we need to go now. Wow. And I said, sure, let's go. And so he's this muscular South Jersey kind of guy who's walking with me. And so as we pull into St. Paul de Vence and we see the you know, the construction equipment, and he says, you know, let's walk and knock on the door. And I was like, it's a construction site. He's like, no, let's go. And he knocks on the door, and the realtors, because the house has been torn down except for a part of it. And the realtors, it's going to be a luxury apartment complex, condo complex, and it has the stunning view. And so it's deeply depressing, right, to see. And they saw us, and the men immediately thought we were some couple who were looking, because I'm in my cream colored jeans and my linen, and he's this big guy. it was amazing. It was an amazing moment, yeah.
feels like I'm hearing about some Woody Allen movie where, you know, you're writing a book and you're researching it, and then there's a flashback to James Baldwin, and then we're in the, you know, it's, there's so many, and you've got to write a book now about the writing of this one.
It's or at least an essay, yeah, really. At some point, yeah. you know. At some point, because I mean, the moment, you know, my first, I think I wasn't in Heidelberg for an hour, and the first thing I see is police officers with their knees in the back of a black man, and his pants are down, his ass is out, he's screaming at the top of his lungs. I think that's the first thing I see. We're going to the Altstadt, the old city, to get my train pass, and there it is, boom, the very thing I just left the States. And the interesting thing about it is that I didn't have to go on television and comment. You know, I just went back to my flat and started writing. You know, just started writing. Yeah. It was a scene that I knew it had to be in the book, and much of that Heidelberg scene that's in Begin Again, I wrote that day.
Wow!
Right, I wrote that day. So just as when I flew back from Nice, I sat down and wrote that part as well. So yeah,
that's amazing. Thank you for sharing.
Yeah, yeah.
That must have been really emotionally jarring.
It was, you know, I mean, you know, that was pretty jarring. It was emotionally draining to see that, you know, Baldwin's sanctuary, his welcome table, was becoming a space for luxury condos. But, you know, it was also the time of the World Cup, so I got to experience Europe in a moment when people were like glued, you know. So I was in France the year France won the World Cup, right? So wow. I was in Nice. So I'm sitting in the alleyways watching, drinking, and watching. And then I went to Germany. Then when I flew back to Heidelberg, Germany had a horrible tournament that year. And so everybody was in deep depression. So it was this really amazing experience. I had never experienced the World Cup in Europe. And so it was just extraordinary. It was an extraordinary experience.
And then you go on to launch the book, and capitals invaded.
When did you release it?
The book came out June 30th.
Oh, right. Oh, sorry.
It was supposed to come out in August, but I was on television, and all of the racial unrest because of the police killings and the El Paso shooting before that. And I found myself, you know, there was this viral video that's gone around the world about me saying, "This is us." And that moment, I was actually channeling something I had literally just written for the book.
Wow.
And so when George Floyd was murdered, 8 minutes and 46 seconds, I kept drawing on my book. Mm. I kept using things in, you know, as I was... I wasn't mentioning the book, but you can. I was in real time. I'm responding to this event, and my editor's like, "Man, you keep giving up the goods. What are you doing?" And
yeah, but you didn't like, say you were.
You know, and yeah. He's like, "You're telling everybody." And I said, "Because I think the book is for this moment." And so my agent and my editor decided to move it up. It was supposed to come out in April, then COVID hit. So they pushed it back to August, and then George Floyd was murdered. And so then they moved it back up. Now that kind of movement around a pub date would kill a book, mm-hmm. You know, but when they moved it to June 30th, it became this thing.
Yeah. Right? The moment. 'Cause
folks were like, "Did he write this yesterday?" Right. It seems too relevant. It seems like he's writing, and they knew given the process, folks knew given the process of book writing that I had turned in a while ago, but everyone thought I had wrote it in real time because of what I was writing about.
That's amazing.
Yes, it was pretty.
Now, I don't know. I mean, you know, I don't know a whole lot about Baldwin. Can you sort of fill me in? I know he was a playwright, and I know he touched on these issues. I haven't seen any of the plays. I haven't read the work.
Oh, my goodness. So the first thing I want to urge you to do is to just go look at some videos. This man is just striking, startling.
Okay.
Born in Harlem in August of 1924, he basically comes of age, you know, he's born in the middle of, or in the moment of the Harlem Renaissance, but he comes of age in Depression era New York. He's not a middle class guy, so he doesn't grow up in Sugar Hill. He grows up in the hood.
Hmm.
Stepfather could barely feed them in the midst of the Depression. The oldest of nine kids. He goes to DeWitt Clinton High School. Not very good because his mind is elsewhere. He's trying to figure out what to do with these stories swirling around in his head, ambivalent about his own sexuality, his own sense of desire.
Yeah, because it wasn't okay to not be heterosexual back then.
No, and to understand who he is. His first novel is Go Tell It on the Mountain. His second novel is Giovanni's Room. And Giovanni's Room is published in 1956, and it's a novel about same-sex love.
Oh, okay.
So.
That was bold of him.
That's an understatement.
Yeah.
That's
good for him. That's, yeah, I you know, I have so much respect for those people that are out there on the leading edge like that.
Yeah, he leaves the States in 1948 and he goes to Paris. He says he had to leave the States because either he was going to kill someone or someone was going to kill him. The rage of growing up. Oh, Jack just froze on us. There you go. The rage of growing up in a country organized along the lines that certain people, that white people ought to be valued more than others, was taking root in him. And so he leaves to go to France in order to will himself into becoming the kind of artist that he would be, that he would become. And there he writes, finishes in the mountains of Switzerland. He finishes on the mountain. He completes Notes of a Native Son. And he becomes James Baldwin in some ways.
Now, did he find the same amount of racism there?
You know, he had an American passport in France, and you know there was an expat community there.
Okay.
So there was a sense, you know, a lot of artists, a lot of jazz artists, a lot of Richard Wright was there, Chester Himes was there, but he saw the racism not necessarily in relation to him as a black man, but he saw it in relation to the Algerians who were there.
Oh.
So the blue passport gave him a certain kind of license. He didn't have to deal with the racism that he would have to deal with here. Mm-hmm. But he didn't trade the American fantasy for the French one. He absolutely saw what the hell was going on there.
That must have been an amazing time, Paris, in that. That was a Woody Allen movie, definitely.
Yeah, man. And then when I was in Heidelberg, I took my wife on a surprise trip. We took a train to Paris and we revisited some of the haunts that Jimmy was.
Be right back.
That he was in, and it was great.
Wow. So. So, you launched this book then, at this time when, I mean, how was the, from here, from Europe, the 4 years of Trump looked a little bit crazy, but so how was it for you over there? It's like can you remember? Did you look like a bad dream?
Let me make sure you're asking me I want to make sure I understand the question. Over there, do you mean here in the States?
Yeah, sorry.
Trumpism? Mm. Yeah, it felt as if white people had lost their damn minds. That's what it felt like, you know, on a certain level. You know, on a certain level. And that Trump had given license to what was already always there, you know. Americans have a tendency to reach for the melodramatic when it comes to our politics. And what I mean by that, we want our heroes and our villains to be clear. And the reason I think we reach for it is that it's an extraordinary way to maintain our innocence. Because we can just simply say that person is the bad person, and then we can displace all of our sins onto him. And then we can expect the hero to come in, or the heroine to come in to vanquish him, or the like, and then all will be well. So there was this tendency, and there continues to be this tendency to exceptionalize Donald Trump, to make him into something. He is the problem, when in fact he's just, you know, a symptom of the rot that's at the heart of the matter.
Well, he kind of, the way I see it, you know, he made what was already in people bubble up.
Right.
The way- bubbled up, and then they sort of had to deal with themselves, and of course they didn't, you know, but yeah, it brought, you know, it just resonated, you know, like music, you know, a guitar string will make something, you know, another one resonate, you know, and it just brought out this negativity that people were suppressing, you know, the people that were vulnerable to it.
Yeah, the way I look at it is I use this analogy sometimes on television, and that is, you know, you can be a diabetic and then you eat something and it'll spike it. You can blame what you ate to be the cause, but the problem is actually systemic. It's in here.
Yeah, exactly. That's a good analogy.
So yeah. Trump, go ahead, Jack.
You say in the book, yeah, the lie, you start with this, the lie. But this is one of them, no?
Yeah, we have to tell ourselves one lie, that, you know, that Trump is the problem as opposed to the, you know, a symptom of a deeper problem, you know? Yeah, absolutely.
I'm just surprised the people that buy into that. You know, I'm in Michigan, and it's so divided here. Look what they tried to do to our governor. You know, it's like, and the lies, and I mean, it's just,
they vote for a billionaire. They vote for poor people. Vote for a billionaire who's not paid his, shown his taxes in ever. That he's going to solve their financial problems. It's like,
yeah, I'm not surprised though.
Yeah, because, you know, I mean, you'd think in the northern states that we have decent education, you know, and then people don't fact check, and, you know.
Remember, Weimar Germany was the most educated public in Europe. Hmm. Education isn't a guarantee against brutality and cruelty.
Exactly. It should be, but. Yeah, because it comes from the heart. Heart and the head are two different things, right?
You know, passions, fears, you know, cruelty, barbarity. Oh,
I got up because I wanted to show you my book.
Oh, yeah.
The Nightmare Book?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, I had a college class, African-American literature, and I liked it so much I saved the book. And is Baldwin in there?
He should be, yes. I think so.
We didn't, for the class one semester, we didn't read everything in there.
Yeah.
But, I thought it was
literally in the mid-20th century, when around the civil rights movement, he definitely would be in there. Or an excerpt from Hotel on the Mountain would be in there. Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
So you go through the book, and another chapter is called The Reckoning, and you tie it all together, and it's a book for these times. So, and we have to write a song about this, so maybe that's something we could talk a little bit about. What, because you've done so many interviews about this book now, you must be tired of this whole questioning process. So excuse me, but if you could just give us if you could sum it up into a 3 minute, what's the big take?
The elevator pitch. How can I describe this?
You said the second and the third founding. Is that the?
Yeah, you know, that's the arc of it. But in some ways, you know, America finds itself again at a crossroads. How will it imagine itself? Will it finally become a genuinely multiracial democracy? Or will it continue to lie to itself about what we've done and who we are? Baldwin had to endure the consequences of America's refusal to grow up, of the country's insistence on lying to itself in order to protect its innocence. And now here we are in the first phase of the 21st century, still grappling with the consequence of the serpent that was wrapped around the legs of the table upon which the Declaration of Independence was signed. The serpent that has threatened to swallow the whole thing whole, the entire thing, since the beginning. So the book is really about detailing the choice that is in front of us. My next book is all about the choice in some ways. Kind of, this is the reckoning. Here we are in the midst of these aftertimes, grappling once again with America's refusal to grow up, having to deal with the consequences of such a thing. What will we do? How will we respond? Will we imagine ourselves anew? And one of the things that I learned from mulling about in the ruins of Baldwin's work, as he described it, is at the heart of the book. Responsibility isn't lost, it is abdicated. And if one refuses abdication, one begins again. So the Sisyphean task isn't about, you know, finally getting the boulder up the hill. You know, I don't want to make Baldwin too much into Camus, but, you know, the meaning is found in pushing the damn boulder up the hill. Mm-hmm. So we continue to struggle, and we will continue to struggle, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think that that's at the heart of the book. You know, Baldwin went through his moment of betrayal with the country. I'm going through mine. Baldwin had to figure out how to pick up the fucking pieces then. I have to try to figure out how to pick up the pieces now. He worried about his nieces and nephews. I'm worried about my son. He's going to have to go through this again. He's going to have to experience what I experienced, what his grandfather experienced, what my grandfather had to experience. He's going to have to deal with this mess.
Do you think there's any progress?
Yeah, of course.
But it's slow.
Well, it's not even, you know, it's not guaranteed, you know. I mean, my dad couldn't go to Princeton, and I'm a university professor at Princeton, right? But it doesn't mean Princeton is somehow better because I'm there. No, you know, the value gap, what I call the value gap, this belief that white people matter more than others and the lies we tell to secure it, is the through line of American history, but it's going to look differently under different material conditions. So what the value gap mean, what it means in the context of slavery, is very different than what it will look like in the context of the first black man in the White House or me being a Princeton professor. But we still live in a society where that valuation is at the heart of the distribution of advantage and disadvantage. So even though my father grew up in Jim Crow, Mississippi, and I didn't, he grew up in a context in which the value gap obtained, and I raised my son in a different environment in which the value gap obtained. So there's progress, but the through line. So this is how I'm, this is what I was trying to struggle with at the level of form, right? What does it mean to not make the claim that nothing has changed? Because it's obvious that something has changed, but at the same time, hold the view that something is still constant. Mm-hmm. And how do you kind of move from an account of the past that then you can pull the thread and show its relationship to what's going on now without creating this genetic kind of account, right, in some way. So I had to figure out that how to do that at the level of form. So it's kind of a mixture of biography, history, and literary criticism, and memoir. And so it had to become it's almost like the chaos of a blues scale, you know. Mm-hmm. It's always, you see what I mean?
Yeah.
So what do you think the solutions are? Do you think that the solutions are self-reflection and acceptance? You know, like,
I think we need to grow the fuck up.
Yeah.
Angela, you know, to be honest with you.
Well, can you expand on that? Like grow up in
sure.
Like I think emotional maturity or?
Yeah, we need to leave behind this idea that because of the color of one's skin, that you ought to be valued more than another. We ought to move beyond our fears of somehow losing something, that the richest country in the history of the world can't bake a bigger pie. So everyone thinks that racial justice is some kind of zero-sum game. So I have to lose in order for you to gain. we have to give up this idea. I think this is not unique to us. And America's sin, by the way, it's our inheritance. It's not ours alone. Right. And so I think we have to give up this idea. Wouldn't it be beautiful to imagine a country without minorities? When we're all just together, right? Can you imagine? Can we imagine a country where we can, or imagine a self where we can, to quote Baldwin, you know, to do something unprecedented, to imagine a self without the need for enemies, and then forge a social contract with each other? So part of what we have to do is to begin to imagine a way of being together differently. And that will begin with concrete policies.
Right? Yeah, I was going to ask, how do politics play into that?
It's at the heart of it, but it's as an ethic at the heart of it too, you know?
Yeah. Because you can force somebody to do something, but you know, the minute the man's not looking, who knows what they're going to do, you know? So yeah, it has to come from that.
I want to force some people to do some things. You know, it's like King said, you know, I might can't convince everyone to love me, but I damn sure don't want anybody to lynch me. So I'm forcing you to not do that.
Yeah.
Right. So I think we need to create a society, right, where there's some basic baseline obligations, basic commitments that we have to each other. And that could create perhaps the conditions for us to be otherwise. But, you know, we got a long way to go for that to happen.
I heard you say in another podcast that you know, if you shoot for the stars, at least even if you don't get it, you can land on the moon.
Yeah, that's something Cornel West told me when I was a young scholar.
Oh yeah,
I'll never forget it. We were in his Cadillac, and he said he was driving us, and I asked it was the cheesiest question. It was just a cheesy, corny question. How do you be great as a scholar? And you know, he gave me that line: you shoot for the stars. You shoot for the stars, and you'll land on the moon.
Okay, that's good.
Shoot for the stars, and you can meet. Yeah, how did you put it? You shoot for the stars, and either you'll land on the moon or on your behind. But either way, take the risk.
God, so many poetic lines we can have in this song. I mean, it practically writes itself. I won't use any Baldwin. Are the family quite litigatory? Are they protecting?
Oh, they're litigious.
Litigious is the word. Yeah.
So, what music do you like?
I like a wide range of music. In the book, I use Coltrane as a way to capture what I'm trying to do at the scholarly level with Baldwin. And I use two tracks from A Love Supreme. One is Pursuance and the other is Psalms. And what I try to do with Pursuance is to say, look, there's this standard way of reading Baldwin that talks about the brilliance of his early work and that his later work is too polemical, it's too bitter, he's lost sight of himself as an artist. And what I try to do is to say, no. There's a continuity of theme in Baldwin's work. He's thinking about those themes under different material conditions, right? As America changes, his return to a particular idea will shift and morph. So what does it mean to think about agency and history and identity in the 1940s or 50s? And what does it mean to think about it in the late 60s and 70s? And so you see the changes and shifts, but there's some continuity. So I use Pursuance. And then McCoy Tyner. And then what does he do? He plays it in such a way. And then you get these chordal combinations by the end that it's almost unrecognizable, but he's doing the same thing. He's still riffing. You still hear it.
That's jazz.
Right? If you pay close attention to it.
Yeah.
Right. You can hear from the beginning, which when it's clear and it's angry and it's biting, it's almost Coltrane's sheets of sound. It's not quite, right? But it's there, right? And so I'm saying this is continuity, right? This Pursuance is a way to read him. Even when he's in his angriest moment,
he's still got the thread.
Then I end the book with Psalms, which is a prayer. Because for Baldwin, salvation is love. So the arc of the book.
Yeah.
Right. That's what I do. in terms of music. Plus, I love blues. I'm a big Bobby Blue Bland fan. Oh. Right, I love the blues. And I think the blues is at the heart of this response that Baldwin gives to this reporter in Istanbul. So Baldwin tries to commit suicide in 1969. King has been murdered in 68, falls apart. A relationship falls apart. And Baldwin always felt that, you know, he was unlovable. Right? Had something to do, I think, with, you know, the cruelty of his stepfather. And so he's in Istanbul trying to put the pieces back together. He's working on No Name in the Street, this book that he described as this mighty motherfucker, you know. And so he's at this thing, and Jimmy's holding forth, and the reporter says, "So what do we do with hope? How do you think about hope?" And Baldwin says, "Well, you know, hope is invented every day." And it's a fascinating formulation. And the reason why it's fascinating, at least to me, is that if you have to, you know, you have to ask the question, why is it the case that it has to be invented every day?
You have to force yourself. Yeah.
No, it means that you're on the verge of hopelessness every day.
Yeah.
That despair is threatening to overwhelm. And see, this is a blues-soaked hope.
Ah.
You see the move? This is a blues-soaked hope. It's a particular iteration of what W.E.B. Du Bois wrote in The Souls of Black Folk in 1903. It's a hope not hopeless, but unhopeful. A hope not hopeless, but unhopeful.
You know, that phrase, that just, you know, makes me think of the situation of minorities in America.
Right. I mean, what does it mean? Yeah. Or poor people in Appalachia, or poor white folks. What does it mean when the world is arrayed in such a way that if you got to figure out how I'm going to get up in the morning? There's a story. Andrew Young, who worked with Dr. King, is a story he tells. King is in a small town in rural Mississippi. I think this is 1967. I think this is the year. And he witnesses white adults letting black kids who are trying to integrate this school out of school early. They let the white kids go out early. When the black kids came out, these adults attacked them.
Oh my gosh.
With baseball bats and tree limbs. And King was so depressed, he went to bed and refused to get up.
That'll do it.
Nothing. And he said when people were fighting in the movement, there were periods when depression would overwhelm and folk would have to take a break. And he said, but we never saw anything like this. He refused to budge. Joan Baez was supposed to be flying in to participate in the movement, in that particular action with him. So she had come in that night, and she sat beside his bed, and she started singing A Pilgrim Sorrow a cappella in his ear.
Oh.
And he heard the second verse, and they said, that's when he stirred. And he looked up, and he got up. So when hope is invented every day, it's when you make the decision to swing your feet off the bed and plant them on the floor and get up anyway.
I love that idea.
Then you might sing a B.B. King blues track. Nobody loves me but my mother, and she could be jiving too. It's a blues soaked hope.
Yeah.
Makes sense, Jack?
Yes, always a lovely. I wish.
Yeah, that's great.
Gosh, you don't want to sing the song. I mean, Angela will give up if you want to take over.
No,
do you sing?
I couldn't care. I can't even lift a note, no less carry one. No, I'm good.
You've got the voice.
You play an instrument?
No, I don't.
Are you sure? Because you knew about the chord changes.
It's pretty easy once you get into it.
Yeah, you know, it's a story. It's going to come out one of these days. I remember when I was a young boy, I wanted to learn how to play the piano. And my dad, who's this really beautiful man, but oh my God, he's so hard. He was such a hard father. And he asked us if we wanted to take some lessons, and my sister was going to take karate, and I said I wanted to take piano lessons, and he said, what are you, a fag? You know, so.
So you didn't? No, I didn't.
But I bought myself a piano, and it's downstairs in my
I just don't have the time to learn how to play. Yeah.
Well, if the writing doesn't work out, you know, if the next book flops, you know, I think you'd be a great singer. So.
Can't keep tune.
So what is the next book then? The more of the solution or the?
Well, you know, I think, you know, it's a trilogy.
Oh, right.
Democracy in Black, How Race Still Enslaves the American Soul was my first trade book, because I have this academic career that I've had for a long time, and then I finally write a book for a broader public. And at the heart of that book is the value gap, right? This belief that, I introduced that language and what we need to do to address it. And then the second book is Begin Again, and at the heart of that book is the lie, right? That's the through line. This book, I think, right now is tentatively titled After This. And at the heart of this is going to be the choice.
I think that's perfect. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have to, you know, there's so much in the world that we cannot control that moves us, you know, so much that moves us about without our say. But there's so much that our say actually matters.
And I think that idea of personal choice is everything. A lot of people don't really know that they have a choice, you know? Like, I mean, in Michigan, like I said, I'm about 45 minutes from Detroit. I was born in Detroit and then, you know, grew up outside of it. But, you know, you go out state and it's, you know, it's so regional. You know, I think that if you're born in a certain area and everybody around you and your family and you, you know, they have this, I don't want to say brainwashing, but I think that some people don't realize that they have a choice. You know, it's like you wanting to play the piano. It's like you got shut down. And I think some people that might say, wait a minute, maybe we all have equal value, they might be shut down, you know. But they might not know that maybe they should revisit that, and they do have a choice. They don't have to think like their parents, and they don't have to think like the people in their local area.
And then there's the other side of it. Some people are actually choosing to be narrow. It's like the difference between being provincial and being parochial.
Yeah, and you know what? You know, we just can't do anything. We just got to let them go. You know what I'm saying?
I actually say that in the book, actually.
Yeah.
We only have a finite amount of civic energy. I want to spend my energy trying to build a new world, not trying to convince people that I'm a human being.
Yeah, because we're never going to convince everybody, you know? And I think about that scene in Titanic. Did you see Titanic, the movie?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
several iterations.
Yeah, the recent Rose and Jack, you know, and where they're, you know, she's on the door and he's dead and she takes his hands off and lets him sink down. You know, I've actually thought of that analogy with some people that used to be friends, you know, that, you know, there's been big divisions, you know, since the last election. And I feel like, wow, I really know who you are now. Mm-hmm. And there's no saving them. There's no talking any sense into them. I just got to just unhook them from the door and let them sink down into that dark little place. It's not good. It's not good down there. They're always angry and they're always upset. And it's like, if you keep pushing against the truth, you're not going to win.
Hmm.
You know?
Yeah. Indeed.
So that's my take.
Yeah. I'm just watching it through a long telescope here from Italy. So, yeah, I know good will ride out in the end. So,
at least that's our hope.
Yeah. Well, this has been really great, Eddie. I think I've heard you on a lot of podcasts, but I think this was fantastic. So to get inside the writing of the book and your personal...
Well, I hope I wasn't too redundant, you know. You talk about these things so much, it becomes rote, you know.
I didn't think it was redundant at all. Nah. Yeah, it was really interesting, you know, because I didn't know too much about Baldwin. I have a piano that's a Baldwin piano. I don't think it's related.
Yeah. I think, you know, one of the things you know, as I'm thinking about how a song could capture what I'm trying to do in the book. There is, you know, I write this line, and I remember when I wrote it, how I felt. You know, I was trying to say that, you know, you can't, to write about Baldwin, to engage him, to deal with him, is you cannot avoid the anger and rage. You cannot try to push it aside. And I wrote, "Rage lights the kiln."
Well, there's our title, Jack. Mm-hmm. Rage lights the kiln, like a ceramic kiln.
Yeah, K-I-L-N, right? It lights the kiln, you know? And it's not, of course, it's not the end all and be all, but, you know, there's this, you know, it's that, like that moment, right? That crescendo and pursuance. I wish I could play it. Have you ever heard Pursuance before?
No.
No.
Oh, safe.
It's a Coltrane,
I mean,
is it?
I've heard Coltrane, but I didn't know the names of the songs. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. It's, I don't know if you'll be able to hear it, but it's the ending, right?
Do you pop? Is that right?
Can you hear this?
Internet? Yeah.
Okay. Let me, you know, they have to put these damn ads up.
I can edit that out.
It's an app.
Oh, that's right. We are recording, aren't we?
Oh, no, I can cut this out. No problem.
Okay.
So rage lights the kiln. That's saying that the heat will create something.
Oh, yeah. You can't. In order to understand the creative process, to understand him, you must encounter the rage.
Yeah.
It's part of what makes us human. But this is the way that the track is introduced. Elvin Jones and this manic drum solo, right?
Drum solos. My brother's a drummer.
It's coming, I promise. Here it is. Sorry?
What's the song called again?
Pursuance.
Okay.
This is McCoy Tyner. It's real. Both hands. I saw your eyes, Jack.
Yeah. I can't play like that.
Don't expect this song for you to sound like that.
Huh? But I wanted you, this is the part that I wanted you to hear. Kind of. This is. I'm sorry. Here we go. Sorry. But this gives you a sense of what I was trying to talk about. And when I just give you an audio visual of rage. Listen. A sound, a sonic representation of.
Thank you. intense.
That is intense, yeah.
And so then it's just gonna, but you just heard the way it began. And so these this combinations, you still hear the thread, you can still hear it. But it's...
Wow. That's musical genius, though. I mean, that's don't set the bar too high, Eddie. You know, let's bring it down.
I think that's a good message.
I just wanted to play it so you can get a sense of what's in my head.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, that's cool. So you're just saying that, you know, despite all this anger and emotions flying, the thread is there. Beautiful. It's always there, and you kind of have to look past the craziness.
Well, not even look past the to understand it. To see the beauty therein.
Yeah.
Right. And then, of course, that song empties out into Psalms. It's going to end up with calm. It's going to end up with prayer. It's going to end up with a declaration of love, you know.
That's cool. But, well, thanks for sharing that.
Yes, thanks, Eddie.
I'm sorry.
No worries.
Sorry. I think it's cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I appreciate y'all.
Great. Thank you so much, Eddie. This has been wonderful.
Y'all take care and stay safe.
All right.
Hey,
have a great day.
Can I send you a song? Can I send you one of my songs?
I would love that.
Okay. Do you want links or MP3?
Link would be better.
Okay. What music service do you listen to?
I don't see. This is what I'm saying. I don't even know. Oh, it's like Spotify.
Apple, Spotify,
iTunes, those sorts of things. Yeah. So anything. Okay. I would love to hear.
I wrote a song about that started to be inspired by the Flint water crisis.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Time for change.
Yeah, I would love that. So.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you for sending it.
So great to meet you.
It's a pleasure. You guys made my day. I appreciate it.
Okay.
Likewise. Bye, Eddie.
Bye.
Wow.
I have a job that I do remotely, and I got my own music going on. I didn't have a whole lot of time to research him and what he's all about, but you know, a lot of what he was saying was kind of over my head. I didn't know much about Baldwin, you know, but now I do, and it was really enlightening and interesting. And
let's get on YouTube tonight and watch some of Baldwin. Get inspired, eh?
Yeah.
Sounds like I hadn't heard of him before either, so yeah.
Well, it seems like a really brilliant, important figure, you know?
Yeah, well, we certainly have enough inspiration here, so let's get stuck on it. I mean, I don't think freeform jazz is way beyond me, so.
Oh, same here. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I don't think he was like expecting us to do anything like that.
More the energy, the anger there. Are you ready to get angry, Angela?
Not really. No.
Are you ready to channel the rage?
I don't think we need to, you know.
you can be angry.
Because you seem to be a pretty quick songwriter, right? How long does it take you to write a song?
About an hour, so.
Wow. It can take me months. So it's good that
No luxury, I'm afraid of that.
Yeah.
I got another four more interviews next week, so I have to get it done. So,
okay.
All right, well, also, if you have any ideas, feel free to work on a song as well. So, you know, we can always
merge
the middle eight.
Yeah, I think that, you know, it sounded like that he was leaning toward this idea of rage lights the kiln. In a song, I don't know how understandable that would be. A lot of people don't even know what a kiln is.
I was thinking more around the lie, which is like like the red line, or just go with the book title Begin Again, you know, the third founding of America, something like that. So,
or the lie is powerful too. I think that people might click on if it's called The Lie. I think that people might click on that song just to hear what the heck it's about, you know. Sometimes the title sometimes the title is everything.
Yeah.
You know.
And then just take what he says, try and get a copy of the PDF of the book, and try and get that just summarize, because he's such a poetic speaker. I mean, just make it rhyme, you know. And then more of a blues style or
blues soul kind of thing.
Blues soul. Cool.
Well, I'm so excited to hear what you do.
Me too.
Okay, cool.
All right. It was lovely chatting to you, Angela.
Okay, you too.
You have a great day.
You too. Okay, bye.
You've been denying me for years. These are deep-seated fears. It's not acceptance. It's not inclusion. It's collusion. It's the lie. It's there for all to see. Implicit supremacy. Why hide it? Why deny it? Why the long face? Why the lie?
Like the song and want to hear it again, it's on Spotify, Deezer, iTunes. You can play it till your heart's content or download it from podsongs.com for $1 and help support the musicians Maurizio Sanicola and Massimino Vozza and my researcher Dori Verbo. Please rate and review the show on your podcast app and share it with all your friends. Thanks for tuning in.